You are a gold mine of talent, but this one talent of yours rises above the rest. So finance fanatics, Miss Anisha is an expert toastmaster. So we have to ask, number one, what is the most pristine tip that you can give to our members to overcome stage fright?
So, you know, this is something which I learned when I joined Toastmasters, because public speaking is the biggest fear anyone has. Even more than death, people fear speaking in public. Right. And of course, the fear is natural. Of course, it comes with practice. But one thing is, no one knows what's on your mind. You know? So definitely you have a winning edge over anyone else. So speak your mind, be authentic, and always be open to new ideas and discussions. You know? So that's the one tip which I can give to anyone who's interested in speaking in public.
Absolutely true, Ms. Anisha. I mean, the ladies and gentlemen, it's actually true. The number one fear is public speaking. Number two is death. So there's this joke, actually. There's a running joke, right? In the Christian community, you have something called as eulogy. So when somebody passes away, everybody gathers and they read out or they speak about that person. So there's one speaker attending to all the relatives. So the joke is, you would rather be in that casket than read the eulogy. Okay, Ms. Anisha, because we have to make the most of, having you over. The second question, this is my last for sure. What is the one most common mistake you see people make which aggravates their fear of getting on stage? I am asking for a friend. Okay, fine, I accept. I get nervous too. Please help me.
I would say in terms of mistake, you know, there are many, and people generally say, you know, I see... Again, it keeps coming back again, but largely I would say the number one mistake is underestimating yourself, you know, because if you don't know where your strengths are and you're not comfortable with what you are today, you'll never be able to speak up. So first, understand where your strengths are, be comfortable with it, and work towards where you're wanting to be.
Lovely answers. I mean, if the start of the session is this, I can only imagine what the session is going to be like. Miss Anisha, stage is all yours. Thank you so much for gracing our session today.
Thank you so much, Nikita. And welcome to all the people today. I hope I make a lot of value add to you. So let me first share my screen. So very quickly, I think I'll not bore you too much, but what I have here is just an overview of what today's whole session is going to be. So there will be panel discussions where you'll get into a lot of individual discussions on specific topics. But this is just a general overview of how the role of finance and how the role of a CFO is evolving over a period of time. So this, I'm sure everyone knows, the pace of change has never been this fast and it will never be this slow again. What has changed over the last 3 or 4 years is significant, and more so in India, because especially in terms of the digital revolution, where we were far, far behind, let's say China or US, now the pandemic has accelerated it to such an extent that there's absolutely no industry, no function, no company which is untouched by this digital revolution. So that's why this is, I think, a very relevant quote to start the meeting today, where the pace of change is something which is unprecedented. Like how we say the times are unprecedented, I would say the pace of change is quite unprecedented what we are facing today. But again, you know, there's hope, there's a lot of invigorating energy behind it. So I think it's a positive news for us. What's different now than, let's say, 5 or 10 years ago is the VUCA world. Everyone talks about VUCA. It's highly volatile, highly unpredictable, and we as finance, we as the CFOs need to manage this volatility, be the kind of the pillars of the business, at the same time foresee what, let's say, the sales or the marketing folks are not able to see today, and protect and drive value for the stakeholders and the shareholders. Right? That's what our key job is. But the good news is, because of the VUCA world, the CFO is at the forefront of the business today. Finance is no longer a support function in any industry. So historically, let's say 20 years ago or even 30 years ago, when we got into the industry, finance was seen as accountants or bookkeepers. What we see finance today as is business partners and value creators. So this is a small chart which I've tried to put in terms of how the role of a CFO has evolved over a period of, let's say, the last 10 years or 5 years. So from being a basic business operator where you're just managing the books, ensuring the basic records, to a business partner, which is pretty much there for the last so many years, where we are partnering with the business on decision support, on risk and compliance, as well as on overall business strategy. The place where today finance is seen as a value architect or a value creator, where we need to manage the volatility. So, you know, so typically a CEO first looks at the CFO to say, you know, tell me what's your recommendation, right? Because there's obviously a sales angle to it, a marketing angle to it. But what really matters is someone who takes into account all these moving variables, all these parameters, and who's able to advise and guide the business in the right direction. A very critical change is, you know, versus cost cut and cost optimization, now it's all about delivering cost advantages. You know, it's a very different way of approaching cost. Instead of even looking at optimizations, it's about saying, where does this cost create value for me in the overall business, right? It's not about saying, should I spend? It's about saying, where can this spend create value for me in my business? It's a very different approach. And of course, the third thing which today any CFO is expected to manage and even drive is the whole digital architecture or the digital strategy for the business. It's a very key thing, which is, you know, very upcoming. But again, as I said, during the pandemic, the pace at which the digital revolution has caught up in India is significant, it's unprecedented. And that's why it's a huge shift for us in finance as CFOs. How do we manage all these changing parameters at the same time? So it's not just about the CFO. Even for our teams, if you see historically versus the traditional view, where let's say 50% of the time and effort were put in transactional accounting and transactional activities, now I would say it's almost 80-20. You know, so 80% of the time is to be spent on analyzing decision support and strategic analytics versus the transactional activities which we used to do, let's say 10 years ago or 15 years ago. So there's been a huge paradigm shift in the expectations, not just from the CFO, but also from our teams. The way we are structuring our teams is going to be very different. A lot of the base activities would be automated or they would be largely process driven. And hence the whole focus of finance is going to be a lot more analytical, a lot more business support driven. There's this joke which goes on WhatsApp and a lot of LinkedIn posts. So, you know, who led the digital transformation of your company? And I'm sure every one of you know, it's not the CEO, it's not the CTO or the CIO. The one who led it was the COVID-19. And it's very true, especially for India, where if you see even all old industries like the FMCG or even some of the earlier industries who were very averse to online, or I would say they were not spending ahead of time on online, have now started looking at direct to consumer. They are having their own portals. They want to reach out to consumers. And again, it started off as a survival instinct because, you know, when the shops are closed, there's no other choice but to reach out to consumer through other ways. But then what it quickly transformed is no longer about the survival. It's not about the need to survive. It's about how do I maximize this riding trend? How do I optimize this trend in a way which is beneficial for the business and to the communities at large? So the waves of digital disruptions which have happened over the last so many years, you know, from 1995 to 2020, if you see, there were certain industries which were touched every 5 years. You know, let's say a market disruptor came in with a new technology, a new offering, a new value creation to the consumer, and he disrupted the market totally. So let's say from the music industry, from the cassettes to everything being online or being on on the system, even the TV, the way it was earlier to now the LED TVs and all the flat screens, and let's say to finance as well as healthcare. So healthcare these days is far more evolved than what it used to be historically. Right, but what has the pandemic done to all industries is there are no more safe havens. There's nothing which will be untouched by digital. There will be nothing which will not have an impact if you are not on digital, right? So eventually it's the reality and we need to adapt to this reality sooner than later. If you ask any CFO today, and I'm saying any CFO in any industry, in any sector, what are his top priorities? I would definitely say the first one would be on keeping pace with the changing technology. And this is no longer about the SAP or the Oracle or the backend accounting or reporting systems in terms of technology. It's a lot got to do with the way we sell, the way we produce, the way we reach out to our consumers and even our talents. You know, the way we retain our talents is going to be very different. Even the work from homes is quite a different way of working, you know, so earlier physical working spaces versus virtual working spaces. So keeping pace with all the changing technology is something which is the number one priority for any CFO today. The second one would be in terms of harnessing and managing big data. So with the new channels that are evolving, let's say online, e-commerce, social commerce, and the multiple commerces and the omni channels that we operate in today, what today the companies have is direct first party information on the consumer. So you know which consumer bought which product of yours when, what is his frequency. Probably you can even search where are the cookies, what else does he do, right? So what this gives you is a huge opportunity to have precision media and precision marketing, which is the marketing spend that you have can be far more effective than before. So if you have this data and you're able to harness it well, you're able to use it well, it will give huge, huge advantages to a company which is able to do. So that's something which plays big because this is the core and the fundamental of business analytics, harnessing the big data that we have eventually. Along with this comes the other part of it, which is risk management. When you're having access to so much of consumer information, it comes with significant amount of data privacy and security risks. That's why it's a very critical area. It's still evolving. There are many countries who have lots of policies on privacy and security. But in India, it's still evolving. And once the government rules are all set, probably there will be something more that we will learn through the course of time. But this is a very nascent area. You know, so while there are disclaimers where you say, you know, your consumer is okay to share this information, but net-net, how we use it, where we use it is something that we really need to be very fair, and we need to be very cognizant of how it will be perceived. It's not about the intent, it's about how we are going to be perceived in using this information and this data. And of course, the basic fundamental of any finance person is cash is king. So we know that irrespective of whichever scenario, whichever pandemic or non-pandemic, cash is king, and the big priority for any CFO is the virtuous cycle of cash. So I would say these would be the top four priorities for any CFO today, and I'm happy to engage and interact with you on these topics through the course of the day. If you have any other differing point of view, if you'd like to understand something more on any of these topics, feel free to post on the chat. We'll have a lovely interacting session. Another question which we as finance need to ask, it's not just about the CFO, it's about the entire finance vertical. A leader is only as strong as his team, right? And that's why the whole evolution of finance is very different today. So if you see in this barometer going from the left to the right, from having very standard workflows to collaborative portals, I think a lot of companies these days have vendor portals and customer portals for login and having online orders. But then it's a lot more got to do with business intelligence and cloud computing. I think almost all the top companies have dashboards, have their KPIs, parameters, which they track on a daily or weekly basis. So I think a large part of the industry is today, fully aware and fully clued on this part, which is, having your own data fully in sync, easily trackable, traceable, and, readable. What is missing, or rather many of the companies are today foraying into these areas, is RPA, which is robotics process automation, artificial intelligence, and analytics. While I would say a lot of companies are still doing RPA in small and big ways, it's largely to take out the pain. The place where RPA is used today is for reducing the frictions, reducing the time spent, and reducing the efforts. But RPA is capable of doing a lot more, and that is something which we still need to explore. Artificial intelligence also, I would say some companies are still in exploratory stage because artificial intelligence takes time to develop over a period of time, where you need a lot of data inputs and it reads and understands. It's like a child which is growing up. So, you know, 5-year-old child versus a 10-year-old child is going to be having very different understanding. So artificial intelligence takes time, effort, and patience to develop. And that is something a lot of companies today are at least experimenting. So I think after we go through all these cycles is where true business analytics and predictive analytics will come in place, where you know, you're able to use external data, internal data, and able to make sense out of how do I run my business more effectively and in a more precise way. You know, it's no longer about sales and marketing. It's no longer about how good your product is. Of course, you need to deliver great products and great services, but it's also about consumer centricity. It's also about consumer acquisition, where it's, you know, consumer is king. We've been always saying this, but now in this new digital world, consumer is really the king. The reviews and the rating mechanisms which we have on various portals, you know, no one is hiding behind any total sales number or profits. It doesn't matter. You could be a very new startup and you could still kill the market leader just by delivering great products and amazing consumer experience. So the whole paradigm of doing business has changed significantly. And that's why having this information is very, very important. And how do we use it is going to evolve over the next few years and decades. I would stop here because I don't want to cover everything that the rest of the panel discussions and the speakers are going to cover during the day. But I would love to leave you with this thought where, you know, it's change is invigorating, it's energizing. And if you don't accept it now, you'll be complacent and you'll be dead and gone. This has happened to a lot of industries and finance is no different. We need to adapt to these new ways and the new mantra of finance or the new mantra for a successful CFO. And that is something which I would love to leave you with. And if you have any questions, feel free to post, ask, and let me know.